Welcome to Seeking the Truth About the Sword of Truth. My name is Tom, and I'll be your guide. This show is going to cover all of the books in the Sword of Truth series, and due to the type of analysis I'm going to be performing, there will be spoilers, heavy spoilers, not just from this book, but from future books. If you have not read the series yet, and intend to do so, read the books first, and then come back and see what I think about them. I'll give you a hint. Spoiler alert, I think they're great. Each of these books contains a record of what happened to these characters in this fantasy setting, and I'll be going through the chapters one at a time to analyze them for content, writing techniques, parallels to science, philosophy, and religion, and anything else that I can find. I'll be pointing out foreshadowing where I can find it. Everybody who's read these books has something in common. We've read the same words, but the one thing we don't have in common is how we saw those words play out in our head. And by exploring these books in this way, I think that we'll be able to expand how we view the series and get even more out of it than we ever thought possible. So welcome to the first episode. We begin our journey in the Heartland Woods at Chapter 1 of Wizard's First Rule. Given that this is the first chapter in a book talking about characters whom we share no history with, the author has the burden of introducing the characters to us in a way that does not distract from the story that he's trying to tell. And I'm going to go over some of the ways that Terry really did a pretty good job of this. So this episode is going to focus heavily on the techniques that Terry Goodkind used to introduce his characters in a way that did not distract from the story that he was trying to tell, as well as set up expectations for almost the rest of the novel. And I want to dive into the first two paragraphs and just show what Terry has done to bring the readers in. A lot of people say that the first sentence hooked them, and I want to tell you why. He is engaging four of the five senses. Think about it. Sight, touch, the feel of the tree, the sound, the smell of the decay. Within two paragraphs, the author has drawn you into a world that you can see, smell, touch, and hear. You don't even know who the main character is yet, and you've already been drawn into this world. We're introduced to the character Richard, and we find that he's searching the woods for something. I want to talk about a technique that Terry Goodkind uses in the first few paragraphs to create a fast bond to the character Richard Cipher. And this is achieved through the completion of a story arc. There are two big examples that you can point to if you want to learn about the science of storytelling. One of them is Joseph Campbell's Hero's Journey that describes what makes up a compelling story from beginning to end and where the resonance comes from psychologically when we hear these stories. Another example of this is the story circle favored by Dan Harmon. He uses it to write much of his stuff. And I'll be focusing heavily on the story circle just because it is a simpler version of the hero's journey, and often the two can be used interchangeably. So the story circle is broken down into eight parts. You have the establishment of the protagonist. That protagonist is given a goal. The character has to leave his comfort zone and go into an unfamiliar setting. He has to adapt to overcome the challenges that he finds. Eventually, he needs to get what he was searching for. Once he finds what he is searching for, some sort of price is paid. And it doesn't have to be a physical or a monetary price, but there is an exchange that then gives the character what they want, but leaves them feeling changed. They are made different by this discovery. And then they are taken back to where they were. And good writers will often chain these things together, where the getting of what the character wants and the payment of the price is what creates the next story circle. So the example that we have right here is, so Richard, the protagonist, begins his call to adventure, which is going into the woods with his friend Zed, to seek knowledge. And together they find it. The price that Richard pays is that he is changed by this knowledge, because as he increases in wisdom, it sparks his hunger to learn even more. When he returns back from where he left, he's a different person, having changed. That is a story circle. This part of this chapter illustrates that Richard views this capacity for change as something that is useful to a person, and that if you build on yourself every day, eventually you can get yourself to a place where you have a large amount of knowledge. And every time we learn something new, that becomes a part of us, and we are a different person than we were yesterday. No man can step in the same river twice. But just that simple story quickly creates a bond that any reader can latch on to about bonding with a parent or a parental figure to grow. We're then introduced to the character Zed, who is taking the role of a fatherly figure and a mentor who is very important to Richard. Next, we're introduced to Richard's father, and we're given a quick story circle to create a bond with him as well. He is the protagonist, a traveler and trader of exotic goods. He leaves his comfort zone and goes into adventure where he seeks these items. He adapts to the things that he finds so he can bring them back. He gets what he wants when he finds the item, but he pays a heavy price because now he is no longer satisfied. Having found the item, there is nothing left for him. He returns home and then begins the process again. That is a complete story circle, and we're given a good picture of who this man was without ever having met him in the space of just a few sentences. It's very well done. By the end of the first page, we're introduced to Richard's brother, Michael. And the novel quickly establishes that the family relationship between Michael and Richard is not as happy as the family relationship between Richard and his father. And that's a theme that we're going to be seeing throughout this book. So then we get into a little bit of the plot. Richard's call to adventure, his first adventure. His father has been murdered. The only clue that he was able to find was a piece of vine that was in a jar that his father used to leave messages for him. His brother Michael said, "I don't want you having anything to do with the search because we have the best trackers on this and you don't need to be involved." Richard takes this as an assumption that his brother is looking out for his best interest. And this is a great example early on of the wizard's first rule before the wizard's first rule is even mentioned. Richard wants to believe that his brother is good. And that is a theme that we see over and over again. Richard always makes excuses and makes allowances for his brother because he's family. And that's what good family does. And you can see from Richard's perspective that family means that you don't give up on somebody. And the author gives us a glimpse at Richard's character when it shows us how he responds to his brother's less than ideal behavior towards his family. He forgives him. He makes allowances. He is his own person, of course, but he does what he can to defend his brother and disagrees when he has to. So Richard shows he's capable of disagreeing with a person, but also having love and respect for that person, which is one of the core traits of his character that you'll see again in the books as well. So in the first chapter, we see our second story circle for Richard play out, where he leaves his home to go on the call to adventure to find this vine that was tied to his father's death. He has to go into unfamiliar settings, the trails that few other people knew about, and the ones he doesn't even visit that often, the ones that are dangerous and close to the boundary. Then he finds what he's looking for. He sees the vine. So after he gets what he wants and pays the heavy price of being bitten by the vine, he is changed by having this thorn wiggle deep inside him and giving him a new concern that he's going to have to follow up in later chapters. We see a little bit of medicine and botany in the section where Richard uses the om plant to comfort the wound on his hand. The medicine closely mimics what we see from the aloe plant, where a clear fluid is used to soothe the pain and speed the healing of cuts and scrapes and burns. The botany comes from the part where Richard takes the part that he broke off, puts a little hole in the ground, and lets it grow into a new plant. That's called cloning in botany. And simply put, if you cut a piece of a plant and put it in the proper conditions, there's a chance that it will sprout roots and grow into a new plant. So the review for scientific realism in chapter 1 regarding the om plant is dead on. That gets an A+ grade. On the fifth paragraph of page 14 in chapter 1, we're given a bit of foreshadowing as the book reminds us a second time that Michael has established that he does not want Richard having anything to do with the search for his father's killer. The next section I want to cover is the whispers in his mind. We're given a couple of paragraphs where the author describes Richard as listening to the whispers in his mind. And anyone who's had an overactive imagination or anxiety knows what those whispers are all about. Their feelings, their tuggings, their dreads. The author goes out of his way to say that Richard feels like this is what he is experiencing. The only reason I bring it up is numerous times throughout the series, we see Richard is guided by his gift on instinct through need, and right now he needs to find that vine. And once he does, the whispers go silent. Given in the second book, Richard's intense denial and hatred of magic, including the lack of ability to accept that he has magic right up till the end of his character arc, it makes perfect sense that he would do everything in his power to distance himself from any sort of supernatural explanation of his feelings. Of course it's his mind. He doesn't have magic. Why would he have magic? He hates magic. I've read these books enough times to say conclusively that I don't know if it was the gift or if it was just his imagination. But I'm unsure enough that I pointed out here. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Is that the gift or is that just a description of his imagination? We're introduced to another character via ominous threat, the red blotch in the sky that Richard sees flying is bigger than anything he's ever seen and never catches a clear glimpse of it before it's gone. Okay, we are still in the first chapter and we need things to be interested in. We're given a mystery right away, and that's just a quick literary technique to introduce something and never speak of it again by the end of the chapter, leaving us to wonder, what was that? Next, we're given a little bit more information about Richard's brother Michael. He is just about to be named the first counselor of all of Westland. Given what I was able to find about the references to their structure of government, it looks to be very similar to a republic. We don't see any mention of Richard's family being tied to government before Michael, so this would not be a monarchy. It's definitely not a democracy because you don't hear about public voting. We don't get into that until Soul of the Fire. The method of appointment is not spelled out, but it seems to be more of a general consent than some sort of official voting. So if enough people in positions of moderate authority agree that Michael will be first counselor, then Michael will be first counselor. And later on, we'll see how Michael goes about establishing that network to get that support. We're once again given another glimpse into Richard's family values, where he remembers his brother's event and how he talks about going there to support him, even though he has previously mentioned that his brother wants nothing to do with him searching for the death of his father, and even goes so far on page 16 on the second full paragraph that Michael would be angry if he knew that Richard was out searching. We see that Michael is the type of person who would be angered by not having control over his brother, and that Richard decides it's best to be his own man out of the view of his brother and support him in his own way by going to his event. Richard once again shows us his ability to live in peace and respect with someone who does not do as he does or believe as he does. Next, we're given a little bit more insight into Richard's backstory. He's a woods guide, and he is used to leading important people around, so he knows to travel. This is just to give us character information. We're also introduced to the concept of the boundary, which is this unknown danger. It's never spelled out at the end of the first chapter. It's left mysterious. It's another mystery for us to figure out in later chapters. We're also introduced to the character of Chase, who is described only as a boundary warden, which reinforces the mystery of what is the boundary. Well, not only is there a boundary that we don't know what it is, but it's so dangerous that it needs warding. What the heck is this thing? We need to figure that out. Very early on, the reader is given the expectation that Terry is one of those guys, one of those authors who likes to end his chapters on some of the most brutal cliffhangers imaginable. And if you've read this series as many times as I have, even when you know what's going to happen, sometimes it's hard to stop reading. And this is a great example of that. As Richard is left with his thoughts, we're introduced to another character, but not by name, just by concept, a woman walking. And we're given another concept. She's being followed by four men. Richard worries about her and recognizes that these men are not following her in a way that is friendly. And Terry ends the chapter, as he does so often, what's going to happen next? Oh no. With the woman being stalked, Richard, seeing that she is in far more immediate danger than she realizes, knowing that this is going to be dangerous, and knowing that he is in a lot of trouble. And we're left to wonder. So if you've picked up this book for the first time and you've made it to the end of chapter one, as the reader, you're given a difficult choice that everyone who's reading a new book has to face. You've just read the first chapter. You have the decision whether you want to keep reading this book. And Terry makes it very difficult to decide to put the book down without figuring out if this woman is going to be okay and who the men chasing her are. In the next chapter of Seeking the Truth About the Sword of Truth, we're going to cover chapter 2 of Wizard's First Rule, where we're introduced to the character Kaylin and shown some of her interactions with Richard. And now, at the end of chapter 1 of Wizard's First Rule, we will be revealing this show's number one quote from the chapter. Please note that the views and opinions of what the number one quote of this chapter is may differ from the views and opinions of what your number one quote from this chapter is. If there is a difference, please leave your number one quote in the comments below. And the number one quote from chapter 1 of Wizard's First Rule is, "It was an odd-looking vine." At the end of every one of these episodes, I'd like to share a short story about Terry Goodkind. I've only got a few stories, and I'm going to start the first few episodes with the ones that I have. Hopefully, by the time I run out of stories that I've had, some of you will have given me your stories about Terry Goodkind that I can share in future episodes. Leave your stories about the author and how he's touched your life, specifically any personal or even written correspondences that you've had with him. I'll be collecting these and, with your permission, mentioning them in future videos. My story is about the time that I wrote Terry Goodkind a letter, and I told him that I was using highlighters to go through his books, and you can see this here. I highlighted all the foreshadowing and all the different things that I thought were interesting that I encourage you to do. And he wrote me back a letter thanking me for my interest, mentioning that I was going to need a lot more highlighters for the next book he had coming out. And he sent me back a very personal letter containing 4 autographed pieces of media, including the bookmark that I'll be using to keep track of our progress through the series. That he took the time to respond in a personal manner and included these autographed things to me, who is somebody he didn't know, meant a lot to me. It showed that he had a dedication to his fans. That's the first story that I have about how my interactions with Terry Goodkind impacted me in a positive way. I look forward to hearing your stories in the comments. If you're watching this video, then you're probably no stranger to people asking you to like, subscribe, and comment on their videos. I'm going to be a little bit different in that sense because I don't like to ask for things from people unless I feel like I've earned it. So unlike the other YouTubers out there, I'm going to ask you to not like, not subscribe, not comment, and not share until you feel you've gotten value out of these videos. And if you don't have that feeling yet, wait for the next episode and see if I can change your mind. Until then, I'm seeking the truth about the sword of truth. My name is Tom, I've been your guide, and I'd like to thank you for watching. If you feel like I've earned it, subscribe and enable notifications so that every time I seek the truth about the sword of truth, you can become a seeker of that truth as well. Thank you, and I hope to see you again.